Hello friends, welcome to daily A12 enrichment program brought by LaExcellis R&D team. Today we will discuss important articles that has been appeared in the newspaper The Hindu dated 29th November 2019. Now let us look into the first newspaper article that reads India's food basket must be enlarged. Agrobiodiversity can help improve the country's poor ranking in the global hunger index. This is the subheading. This topic can be linked to the syllabus GS2, that is issues relating to poverty and hunger. Then population issues. For prelims, we have to cover on global hunger index and its key facts and performance of India. And for mains, we have to study on global hunger index findings, highlights, concerns, challenges, remedies, and finally, the importance of agrobiodiversity in curbing the hunger in India. Let us cover some basics on global hunger index. What is global hunger index? It is an international tool which is designed to comprehensively measure and track hunger at global, regional, and national levels. Global Hunger Index scores are calculated each year, that is annually, to assess progress and setbacks in combating hunger. They help in raise awareness and understanding of the struggle against hunger and provide a way to compare levels of hunger among the countries. This report is a peer-reviewed publication which is released annually by Welthungerhilfe and Concern Worldwide. Welthungerhilfe is a German organization and Concern Worldwide is an Irish agency. The 2019 Global Hunger Index report has been released and this time India has ranked 102 out of 117 countries. And India had ranked 103 among 132 countries in 2018. Global Hunger Index ranks countries on a 100-point scale with 0 being the best score, that is no hunger, and 100 being the worst. Values less than 10 reflect low hunger. Values from 20 to 34.9 indicate serious hunger. Values from 35 to 49.9 are alarming. And values of 50 or more are extremely alarming. Global Hunger Index tracks the performance of different countries on four key parameters. That it provides a far more comprehensive measure of hunger. Those four indicators of Global Hunger Index are undernourishment, child wasting, child stunting, and last one is child mortality. Talking about undernourishment, it reflects the inadequate food availability and it is calculated by the share of population that is undernourished, that is whose calorie intake is insufficient. And then child wasting, it reflects acute undernutrition, the share of children under the age 5 who are wasted, that is we have to understand the definition of wasting here. We shouldn't get confused between the definitions of wasting and stunting. Here wasting means those who have low weight for their height. That is, if the child has low weight for its height, according to the standards, then that child is termed as wasted child. Next comes the child stunting. It reflects the chronic undernutrition and this is the share of children under the age of 5 who are stunted. That means those who have low height for their age. That means if the child has a low height for its age, then this condition is termed as child stunting. Then comes the fourth indicator of Global Hunger Index, that is child mortality. It reflects both inadequate nutrition and unhealthy environment. And this is calculated by the mortality rate of children under the age of 5. And here, what is mortality rate? Mortality rate or death rate is nothing but a measure of the number of deaths in general in a particular population scaled to the size of that population per unit of time. Now, let us look into the key findings of Global Hunger Index report. The first key important finding is that India is one of those 47 countries that have serious level of hunger. Here, serious means it has a score value of in between 20 to 34.9. Then, number of hungry people has risen from 785 million in 2015 to 822 million. Multiple countries have higher hunger levels now than in 2010. And also, another finding is that approximately 45 countries are said to fail to achieve low levels of hunger by 2030. Among the BRICS countries, that is Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa grouping, India has ranked the worst with China at 25 rank. Within South Asia, India is behind Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bangladesh and Pakistan. Some of the other countries that is ahead of India are Saudi Arabia, which has ranked 34, Venezuela, which has ranked 65, and then North Korea has ranked 92. Now, let us study what are the concerns for India with regard to Global Hunger Index report. The first thing is, with an overall score of 30.3, we have ranked 102 this time. In the year 2000, India's score was 38.8. This time, 30.3. And in 2000, it was 38.8. And we have to remember the fact that lower the score, best the performances. And in 2000, our anger level was in the alarming category. And now we are in the serious category. Since then, India steadily improved on most counts to reduce its score and is now slotted in the serious category. But the pace of India's improvement has been relatively slow. Despite achieving relatively fast economic growth since 2000, India has not been able to make many strides in reducing anger. Now, what are the reasons for slow improvement in India is, first thing is child wasting and next is child stunting. Coming to child wasting, India has performed very worst in this case. In other words, the percentage of children under the age of 5 years suffering from wasting has gone up from 16.5 in 2010 to 20.8 in 2019. India's child wasting rate is extremely high at 20.8%, the highest wasting rate of any country in this report. And then moving to India's child stunting rate, 37.9% is also categorized as very high in terms of its public health significance. In India, just 9.6% of all children between 6 and 23 months of age are fed a minimum acceptable diet. In India, to combat the malnutrition levels, both immediate and long-term interventions are needed. Now, the nutritional rehabilitation centers are coming up across the country. It can help in taking care of the institutional needs of the children who are already malnourished. Then, there is a need to spend more money on health, education, and social sector. And also, attention to agriculture is the need of the hour. And there was a time when agriculture was contributing immensely to the Indian GDP. But today, its contribution is decreasing every year, and people seem less interested in farm sector. That is the reason we see a large migration to the urban areas. So this is also one of the hidden reasons behind malnutrition. And then we need a development model which ensures high growth, distribution of wealth, creation of jobs, and mix of technology so that large number of people benefit from this growth. In terms of global hunger, the Brazilian model was successful. The center of the policy was women. The money was transferred to women. Women should ensure that the child is taken to the school and to the primary healthcare centers. It was a PPP model. It was a model where federal government, state, and local government came together. We need to learn from the global experience. Then, along with the government, there are certain things which women alone can do, that is, breastfeeding the child. The government is working to spread the awareness regarding the importance of breastfeeding, which can take care of undernourishment of the children. Some of the recent initiatives underway include the launch of Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana, that is PMMVY, in 2017, which is a conditional cash transfer scheme which transfers 5,000 rupees for pregnant women and lactating women, under which more than 98.16 lakhs of beneficiary women have benefited till now. Additionally, we have Poshan Abhiyan, that is the National Nutrition Mission, launched in 2018, which focuses on first 1,000 days of child's life, convergence across ministries and departments, real-time Aadhaar-linked beneficiary level monitoring, and performance-based joint incentives for frontline workers. Then there is a launch of rotavirus vaccination to prevent diarrhea is also another initiative. And in 2014, the Prime Minister has initiated Clean India campaign to end open defecation and ensure that all households had toilets. And with the use of technology and community mobilization, it will be possible to see some potential outcomes through better health and well-being of all women and children. Now, coming back to the newspaper article that reads India's food basket must be enlarged. In this article, initially, the author talks about the new set of guidelines that has been released by the Ministry of Human Resource and Development, that is MHRD, instructing schools to set up nutrition gardens, also called as kitchen gardens. The proposed nutrition garden would help in addressing issues such as malnutrition and micronutrient deficiencies among school children. In addition to the nutrition aspect, this garden would also pose as experimental learning for students. That means it will help the students to identify fruits and vegetables best suited to topography, soil and climate. And these gardens can also give students lifelong social, numerical and presentation skills and also care for living organisms and teamwork. And under this initiative, school can seek technical, infrastructural and other assistance from agencies and various government departments. One of the main objectives behind setting up these gardens is to teach the students the skills of growing their own food. The guidelines formulated by MHRD also outline how the nutrition kitchen gardens can also contribute to reducing the effects of climate change. Besides, Procuring the food locally would reduce the need for the food transportation, thus decreasing carbon emission from fossil fuels. Then, in this article, the author talks about the agrobiodiversity. In order to increase the India's food basket, then agrobiodiversity is the best option, he says. Agrobiodiversity or the agricultural biodiversity is a broad term that includes all components of biological diversity of relevance to food and agriculture, and all components of biological diversity that constitute the agricultural ecosystems, also named agroecosystems. The variety and variability of animals, plants, microorganisms at the genetic, species and ecosystem levels. Then in the article, the author says, we have been using just 7,000 plant species out of 2.5 lakh globally identified plant species. And from the base of what's agriculture, we use only 30 crops, and just 3 species of maize, rice and wheat supply more than half the world's daily calories. So agrodiversity or genetic diversity of crops, livestock and their wild relatives are fundamental to improve crop varieties and livestock breeds. And the important fact to note is that India is a center of origin of rice, brinjal, citrus, banana, cucumber species. And across the world, 37 sites are designated as globally important agriculture heritage systems. And among them, 3 are in India. That is in Kashmir, we grow saffron. Then Koraput, where traditional agriculture is practiced. And this place is in Orissa. And then Kuthanad, where below sea level farming is practiced. And this place is in Kerala. And then the author mentions promising genetic resources, which includes rice from Tamil Nadu, Konamani, and rice from Assam called Agnibora, and Kerala called Pokhali, Balia wheat and mushroom from Guchi from Himachal Pradesh. And then he mentions the number of rich form animal native breeds. In cattle, we have 42 native breeds. In buffaloes, we have 15 native breeds. Goat 34, sheep 43, and then chicken, we have 19 native breeds. Finally, he says agrobiodiversity helps nutrition sensitive farming and biofortified foods. For example, drumstick has micronutrients and sweet potato is rich in vitamin A. Then there are varieties of pearl millet and sorghum rich in iron and zinc. Then the author talks about 2 developmental goals. First one is being United Nations Sustainable Development Goal, SDG 2, that advocates for zero hunger and also which seeks to end hunger and all forms of malnutrition. Then comes the Aichi biodiversity target, which focuses on countries conserving genetic diversity of plants, farm livestock and wild relatives. And this target was adopted by the CBD, that is Convention on Biological Diversity, at its Nagoya conference. And then in 2019, the Center for Biodiversity Policy and Law recommended to increase India's agrobiodiversity. And this includes a comprehensive policy on ecological agriculture to enhance native pest and pollinator population, providing ecosystem services for the agricultural landscape. It also suggested promotion of the bio-village concept, and also recommendations included encouraging community seed banks in each agroclimatic zone so that regional biotic properties are saved and used by new generation farmers. And then in the conclusion part, the author says that it is important to conserve the traditional varieties, and then we have to enlarge the consumption pattern and culinary diversity in order to increase our India's food basket. And then another recommendation he adds is that we have to mainstream the biodiversity into agricultural policies, schemes, programs and projects to achieve India's food and nutrition security and minimize genetic erosion. Now moving on to the next article, it reads widening gap. India must use green technologies to boost growth and become a climate leader. This is the subheading. And this topic can be related to the syllabus GS3, that is conservation, environmental pollution and degradation, environmental impact assessment. And for prelims and mains, we have to study on key findings, climate change, challenges present and ways to address them. Now let us cover on emission gap report. The emission gap report is released by UNEP, that is United Nations Environment Programme. And this emission gap could also be called as commitment gap. It measures the gap between what we need to do and what we are actually doing to tackle climate change. This gap is the difference between the low level of emissions that the world needs to drop to compared with a projected level of emissions based on countries' current commitments to decarbonization. Now, let us see why does this emission gap report is important. This gap report is important because if we can't close this gap and meet the emissions reduction target, we will face increasingly severe climate impacts worldwide. It is important that policymakers and their citizens know what the gap is, so that the commitments countries are making are sufficient to close the gap. The emission gap report measures and projects three important key trend lines, that is, the amount of green gas emissions every year up to 2030, the commitments countries are making to reduce their emissions, and the impact these commitments are likely to have on overall emission reduction. Then the pace at which emissions must be reduced to reach an emission low that would limit temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius affordably. Key findings of the report. The world will fail to meet the 1.5 degrees Celsius temperature goal of the Paris Agreement unless global greenhouse gas emissions fall by 7.6% each year. Global temperatures are set to rise about 3.2 degrees Celsius by 2100. And the report says it brings catastrophic weather, including hotter, deadlier heat waves and more frequent floods and drought. Then the top four emitters, that is China, USA, European Union and India, contributed to over 55% of the total emissions over the last decade, excluding emissions from land use change such as deforestation. Then rankings would change if we consider land use change emissions. Then Brazil will likely to be the largest emitter. Position of India. India is the fourth largest emitter of greenhouse gases, that is, it is among small group of countries that are on their way to achieve their self-declared climate targets under the Paris Agreement. Then coming back to the newspaper article, here the author says that this emission gap report gives a sharp warning to the countries who are preparing to meet at 2019's United Nations Climate Change Conference, also known as COP25. In order to achieve the objective of the Paris Agreement, that is, to keep the rise in global temperature over pre-industrial times well below 2 degrees Celsius and ideally at 1.5 degrees Celsius, UN report estimates that there would have to be a 2.7% average annual cut in emissions from 2020 to 2030 for temperature rise to be contained at 2 degrees Celsius. Then, in order to achieve an ambitious target of 1.5 degrees Celsius, then it would require a 7.6% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions. Then, the author talks about the actions taken by many governments with respect to climate change. In the US, the Trump administration has initiated the process of withdrawing Paris Agreement, but there is a considerable subnational support for climate actions. In European Union, public pressure is very high with respect to climate change, and they are working on legislation to bring about net zero emissions. Then the UK, which is responsible for a large share of historical emissions, which has turned its net zero 2050 goal to a legal requirement. So for these rich nations, he says that the road to lower emissions is mainly through innovation and higher efficiencies. But China and India, they have to take a path of growing emissions with developmental needs. The best options for developing nations is that increase the investments in renewable energy and then bringing clean technologies in buildings and transport and greater carbon sequestration. It needs to provide more consistent support for renewable energy, have a long-term plan for retired coal power plants, enhance ambition on air quality, adopt an economy-wide green industrialization strategy and expand mass transport. And we have to push for energy conservation building code for residential buildings to push for energy efficiency in residential sector under Energy Conservation Code of 2018, which aims to benefit the occupants and the environment by promoting energy efficiency in design and construction of homes, apartments and townships. Now, moving on to the next article, it reads, should life convicts be denied remission? This topic can be related to the syllabus GS2, that is government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of the design and implementation. For mains, we have to cover on policies of state governments releasing prisoners early. Recently, the Tamil Nadu government released 13 prisoners who were serving sentences for the death of 6 Dalit men in the village of Melavalavu in 1997. And this move invited a swift disapproval from the Madras High Court for what it saw the government's haste in releasing them on grounds of good conduct. In this article, they discuss about the constitutional position on remission and the procedures through which it is exercised. And here, they mentioned that prisons are usually released on birth or death anniversaries of prominent popular leaders. And the list is not announced instantly, but there is a proper procedure and also there is a sentence review board. And each state has its own prison rules. And when it comes to prison, it is a state subject. So every state has got own prison manuals. And then some prisoners are entitled to consideration for early release after completion of 14 years. And in certain categories, it is about 20 years. So 6 months before they are nearing to 14 or 20 years, the prison authorities will assess whether the person is eligible for remission and also whether his family is in socio-economic need and whether he will be useful for society or not. And when a court says that a person is sentenced to life, that does mean till the end of natural life. That means that the person is no longer going to get any remedy from the court, and also the court's position is that there is no automatic right to release. And in prison manuals, there is a mentioning of calculation of remission period. And in many of the cases, it is observed that there is still early release of prisoners. And the court is concerned about this matter. According to section 433 mentioned, there is a limitation that one cannot be released unless you have served 14 years in prison. But the court has clarified that this doesn't mean that you are automatically entitled as a matter of right to be released after 14 years, but this is just the minimum period. In V. Sri Hariharan case, that is Union of India versus V. Sri Hariharan 2015, who is the person convicted in the Rajiv Gandhi case. In this case, the court considered the question of whether the court can exclude the remission powers of the government under section 432 of the Criminal Procedure Code. But in this case, the Supreme Court said that in all of these cases, the appellate court, that is High Court or the Supreme Court, can explicitly mention or exclude the remission powers of the state government or the central government under section 432 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Limitations for calculating the remission period. In reality, our Indian prisons don't have the infrastructure, investment or the expertise to really make this assessment meaningfully. Then the author says, the question of remission is essentially a question of reformation. If the person is reformed in true sense, then he deserves remission. Now moving on to the next topic, that reads, not as you say, but as you do. It is with respect to India and Sri Lanka relationship. This topic can be related to the syllabus GS2, that is India and its neighborhood relations. And for mains, India and Sri Lanka relation, concerns, challenges and ways to address them. In this article, initially, the author talks about the relationship between the Modi government and the Rajapaksa regime. In the past, Mr. Rajapaksa has made an allegation that Indian intelligence agencies had conspired for their electoral loss in 2015. So, the author asks the question, will actually be they are able to forget the deeply bitter history they have shared for the last few years? And one such area that is likely to help the process of building a successful relationship in between New Delhi and Colombo is that rapid improvement in intelligence sharing. And another pillar of bilateral ties in the region rests on developmental projects and economic relations. India is already involved in Sri Lanka with interests in building infrastructure in the northern and eastern provinces, including upgrading the Jaffna-Colombo rail track and other railway lines, providing electricity transmission lines for power imports from India, and rebuilding the Concession to Rai Port. And then the author says that completion of those projects which were signed during 2017 regime should become a priority, including India's plan to develop Trincomalee Port and oil tank farms and LNG terminals near Colombo. Then author puts a critical opinion that India's internal issues like deletion of Article 370, the Citizenship Amendment Bill, NRC and detention center for illegal residents and case of mob lynching will impact our neighborhood relations. Now moving to the way forward. As both the countries have a democratic setup, there is a scope for broadening and deepening the ties. And then India needs to focus more on its traditional and cultural ties to improve relationship with Sri Lanka. Thank you for watching.